morning, everyone. I hope you guys slept well after, you know, a night of worship and fun, you know, with the breakout sessions and whatnot. Yeah, but at this time, why don't we prepare our hearts once again for worship? So let's close our eyes and bow our heads. You know, at this time, why don't we, you know, just thank God for letting us wake up this morning, for letting us come together as a group, as we, you know, worship Him once again. Yeah, so why don't we just thank God, you know, for all that He has done in our lives. Yeah, let's take some time to pray. Wake up this morning, God, for giving us another opportunity to worship You for the God that You are, Lord, for giving us another chance, you know, to bring glory to Your name, Lord. You know, I just ask, God, that as we have, you know, a day full of, you know, activities, Lord, that that we would not get lost in the festivities, Lord. We would not, you know, be consumed by the fun, Lord, but that we remember why, you know, we are here. It is to know You more, God. To know You more is to love You more, God. We thank You for all things, and we give You all the glory. Jesus, let me pray. Amen. of every fear. Like the sun shaping the shadow. In my weakness, your glory appears. Sing, I'm not enough. Thank you. Yes, Father, you know, you are so good to us, Lord. You are perfect in all of your ways, Lord. And there is no way we could even fathom the love that you have for us, God. Ask, Lord, that as we continue through our lives, Lord, that we would not take this life for granted, Lord, that we would not take you for granted, God, but that, you know, every day, every moment of our lives would be for you, Lord. It would be for your kingdom come. I just ask that you would be with us for the rest of the day, Lord, as we continue through this retreat, God. Let us learn more about you. Thank you for all things. In Jesus' name we pray.
What's up, New Life YG? Hope you guys were able to get a great night's rest. Hope you guys feel energized and rejuvenated, ready to tackle on another day, because we are now officially in session 2, day 2 of your annual winter retreat. Now, like I said yesterday, last night, one of the keys to experiencing and receiving more of God is actually hunger. The Bible says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. It's a promise. And so if you guys want to genuinely receive all that God has for you, because we're only in session 2, we still got 2 more days left. I need you guys to really get excited, get expectant. Let faith arise, be hungry for all that God has in store. I don't know what went down yesterday afterwards. Hopefully you guys had a chance to process some of these things that happened. Hopefully you have made a decision once and for all. No more, Pastor Danny. I broke my alabaster jar. I'm all in for God. And if so, let's continue on this journey with the theme of this retreat being love. Come on, somebody write that in the chat down below. Write love. I don't know why I gotta do that with my hands. Something about love. Love. We're gonna continue on with our theme for love. And today's session, we're actually going to be talking about one of the topics, which is loving yourself. Now, I have a question for you, YG. I have a question. Let's see who here knows the Bible really well, okay? How many times did God or Jesus command the people to love themselves? How many times does it say in the Bible to love yourself? I'll give you guys 5 seconds to think about it. Ready? Go. All right, time's up, YG. Just give me a show of hands if you said one time. Pastor Danny, it comes out one time in the Bible. Give me a wave of hand. Okay. Give me another wave of hand if you say, Pastor Danny, it came out 2 times. 2 times. Give me a wave of hand. All righty. 3 times. 3 times. Anyone? Wave of hand. Okay. Now, if you say 4 times or more, I'm going to pray for you because you don't know the word. I'm just kidding, YG. All right, let's talk about this. For those of you guys who said 1 time, 2 time, or 3 time, are you guys talking about the passage where Jesus tells the people, hey, love your neighbor as yourself? Is that the passage you guys are referring to? Because if so, you are incorrect. YG, it was a trick question. The answer is actually 0 times. You can search all throughout the Word of God, all 66 books from cover to cover. You won't actually find a single place where the Bible tells you to love yourself. Now, for the Bible scholars out there, you might be wondering, well, Pastor Danny, what about the passage you just mentioned? I mean, you just said it yourself. Didn't Jesus say to love your neighbor as yourself? He did say to love your neighbor as yourself, but the context is that he was actually referring and talking to a bunch of people that were so in love with themselves. They are like the self-obsessed people. You know what I'm talking about? The ones that can't stop thinking about themselves. The ones who can't stop looking at the mirror. They want the best for themselves. They always need to come in first place. They always need to have the best of the best of the best. They take care of themselves first. Jesus is telling those people, hey, look, guys, I got a challenge for you. Why don't you love your neighbors just as much as you love yourself? He's saying, I know how much you love yourself. Love your neighbors as much as you love yourself. So it was a challenge, never a command to love them. It was a command to love the neighbors. I know, very interesting. So the Bible actually tells you 0 times to love yourself. Well, if that's the case, then why are we talking about this topic? That's a great question. Here's the thing about loving yourself. The Bible, if you read carefully, it actually tells you the opposite. 2 Timothy chapter 3 actually tells you that more and more the world is going to get darker and the world is going to get more evil. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, this is what it says. It says, in the last days, people will be lovers of self. People will be lovers of self in the last day, and it goes on to list more and more sin. So what the Bible is actually saying is that they put loving yourself, being lovers of self, in the same category as other sins. So Pastor Danny, why are we talking about this topic? If the Bible says loving yourself and being a lover of yourself is just as sinful as some of these other things, then is this something we're supposed to do? Kind of. There's a principle here. The principle is not to love yourself, but the principle is to actually get to a place where you fall content and satisfied in who God says you are. That's why in night number one, session number one, we had to get to a place where we fell in love with God. We realize how much God loves us, and therefore we're laying everything down. Because from that place, why do you remember what I said? It's the gateway to experiencing the fullness of God. And what we're going to uncover today is, how do you get to a place where you don't love yourself? No. How do you get to a place where you are now fully satisfied and content in all that God says you are, in all that God has created you to be, in the fullness of who God has created you to be? How do we get to that place? How do we end up falling in love with God and who God claims to that we are? That's what we are going to discover today. And so if I could sum it up in one word, what we're going to be talking about today is this key word right here. You ready? One word. Identity. 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 You guys get it? Identity. It's so crucial we talk about this. This word right here, identity, will actually be what you will discover through today's session. Identity, and your identity specifically related to God, is what we will uncover, and you'll begin to realize this might be the most important lesson you learn. If you get this down, if you get identity down, I promise you, YG, no matter what your life looks like, no matter where you go, you will not falter, you will not hesitate. As a matter of fact, once you get identity down, that is the foundation to actually building, and getting deeper and deeper and deeper with God, in God. But it comes down to identity. Now, it's very important we understand this. Today, I'm actually going to be sharing a lot more stories about my journey trying to discover my identity. Because your generation, Gen Z, you guys, in my honest opinion, as I research you guys more and more and more, you guys are by far the most gifted, the most actually amazing generation I think that has ever walked this planet. You guys really are. I'm going as far as to say this, your generation will actually be the closest to finishing the Great Commission. Actually, you guys are on track. Your generation is on track to see the completion of the Great Commission. That's how important your generation is. Incredibly gifted. But at the same time, your generation is also the most confused generation. Why do I say that? Because for so long, you guys and your generation have been hearing what your identity is from other sources and other means. For example, social media. Everyone is trying to tell you who you are. Social media is trying to tell you you have to be a Democrat. Social media is trying to tell you you have to look like this. Your friends are trying to tell you this is who you are. Even your family might try to tell you this is who you are. This is what you must be like. Society and the world is trying to tell you what you do equals who you are. So therefore, this is what you must do. This is who you must be. So your identity, your generation, although it is the most gifted, it is the most, in my humble opinion, the most awesome generation, you guys are also the most confused because of identity. But I believe New Life YG, you guys are set apart. New Life YG, you guys are going to be an example to your generation on what it looks like if a group of people who fully know their identity and fully know God, if they walk this earth, what they could do, the power they have, the way they could change this world. You guys are going to be that example. Amen. Oh, come on, I need y'all to be excited. Write in the comments down below, amen. There you go. So what we're going to uncover today is identity. And I'm going to do my best to keep this not as long as yesterday. I know yesterday went on for over an hour. I was surprised too. So we're gonna keep this a little bit shorter today. So if you have your Bible, turn with me to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, starting from verse 14. And I'm gonna be reading from the NIV. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. Can everyone say children? The Spirit you received does not make you slaves so you live in fear again, but rather the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship, and by Him we cry, Abba, Father. Pause right here. What is he trying to say? YG, this is so important we catch this. What the Bible is trying to say is this, that because of the Holy Spirit, that if you are a born again believer, you are a child of God. You are now a part of His family. But here's the crazy part. Not only are you just a child of God, the Bible actually says that God has adopted you and actually determined that you are now placed into sonship. Now this word sonship, what it's talking about, is actually talking about the cultural sonship of back in this day. What do I mean? The Bible is referring to first son born status. Firstborn son status. Firstborn son status. In other words, back then, the firstborn son was the rightful heir to receive all of the father's possession. The firstborn son was the rightful heir to receive all that the father has. The Bible is actually saying that you guys, if you guys are a born again believer, what God has done, He has adopted you, and now He has placed you as firstborn son status. In other words, all that God has, He desires to give to you. All that God is, He desires to give to you. It's incredible we catch this. Now let's keep reading verse 16. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs of Christ. Sorry, I read that wrong. Co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in His sufferings in order that we may also share in His glory. YG, today I'm not going to break this apart. I'm not going to go through it verse by verse. As a matter of fact, I just want to share with you life lessons I've learned on identity. This passage is very important and this passage is key because what it's saying is that our primary identity is not that you are Korean. Our primary identity is not that we are American. Our primary identity is not that we are Republican, is not that we are Democrat. Our primary identity is not that we are in school or we are a dropout. Our primary identity is not that we are successful or not successful. Our primary identity is not that we have a crazy amount of followers on Instagram versus not. Our primary identity is first and foremost that we are children of God. It's important we catch this. Your primary identity, the main identity, who you truly are, is not that you are anything else except this. You are first and foremost a child of God. That identity right there, the primary identity, it seeps through every other identity of yours. You are a child of God, therefore it impacts the way that you are in school. It impacts the way you are a student. It impacts the way that you are a friend. It impacts the way that you are a child to your parents. It impacts the way that you are a part of your church. Your primary identity is first and foremost that you are a child of God, and it's important that we catch this. Now for me growing up, the biggest lesson I probably learned is on identity. It was the biggest struggle of my life. And as a matter of fact, it was the life lesson for me, discovering my God-given identity. Now I don't know about you guys, I would love to, like I said yesterday, I would love to meet you guys so badly. But for me growing up, our family moved to this area back in 2001 when I was in second grade. And it was this area called New Rochelle in New York. And it was predominantly African American and Hispanic. Now, while we were living there, back then, this is what, 19 years ago. So, shout out to BTS who put Korea on the map. Suga, 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 Jimin, J-Hope, RM, I don't know who else, all of them. But then back then, no one knew of Korea. And as a matter of fact, starting from second grade was when I realized I had a different identity. It was the first time my identity was actually challenged. And it was the first time people began to say to me, "Hey Danny, why do your eyes look like that? Hey Danny, why can't you see me?" And they would pull back their eyes like this. They would make weird sounds with their mouth, ching chong, ching chong. I mean, I laugh about it now, but they say like, "Is your father Jackie Chan? Is your father Jet Li, Bruce Lee?" Like really weird stuff. I mean, I could laugh about it now, but back then they said something else. They were saying jokes to me. They're like, "Yo, Danny, is your Asian name the sound it makes when we drop a quarter in a sewer?" I'm like, "What? Clink, 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 clink." Like really messed up stuff. I hope none of you guys are offended. Back then I was ready to fight. I was like, "Yo, what?" Anyways, come on. Jesus redeemed me. He sanctified me. I'm saved. But back then it really hurt. My identity was always being challenged and questioned. I mean, I even played ball. I was pretty good, if I do say so myself. Come on, YG, any ballers? But here's the thing. I played ball, but because I was Asian, people would say, "Yo, Yao Ming. Yo, who got Yao? Who got Yao?" There's a famous streetball player, professional streetball player. His name is Hot Sauce. That's his nickname. You know why? Because he's spicy. Yeah. But I'm Asian. So you know what they called me? They said, "Yo, who got soy sauce?" Literally, that's what they would say to me. Messed up. But it was the beginning of genuinely trying to discover my identity, because for the first time, people were attacking my identity. People were trying to tell me who I was. And now I got to a place where now my identity was so confused, I actually began to live for the applause of people, for the approval of people. And in many ways, this right here is my life story. This is my life journey. These are the life lessons that I've learned about identity. So I want to share with you three life lessons, three lessons on identity. And if you are taking notes, I encourage you, YG, take notes. You get this, and I promise you, you will understand identity and how important it is. So lesson number one, I'm going to be moving quite a bit around scripture. Lesson number one on identity. No person can give you identity. If I were to phrase it a different way, your identity cannot come from other people. That means your friends can't tell you who you are. That means that other people in your life can't dictate who you are. That means social media cannot tell you who you are. That means that your school cannot tell you who you are. Other people cannot validate you or give you worth regarding your identity. It's really important we catch this. If not, what we're gonna do, like me, you begin to live for the approval of other people. You begin to live for the recognition of other people. You begin to live because you're people pleasing. Because they begin to feed identity to you. Yo, if you're really my friend, do this. Yo, if you really wanna be a part of my crew, go ahead and do this. And they will try to begin to manipulate you in such a way where they will say, "You must do this in order to be a part of us." And they will try to speak identity to you, but newsflash YG, people cannot give you your identity. Your identity cannot come from other people. It's crucial we catch this. There's a story in the Bible of King Saul. I don't know if you guys know who King Saul is. He's the first king of Israel. And the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 13, King Saul started off really good. He was God's anointed, God's appointed. And he was really good when he first started off. But more and more, because of a lack of identity, what he would do, he would find his identity from other people. He was now people pleasing. He wanted to get people's approval so bad, he began to compromise his convictions, compromise what was right, solely because he wanted to get people's popularity. It's true. And the Bible says in 1 Samuel 13 that King Saul did something that he was never supposed to do. King Saul, because he was more afraid of what people would say, ended up offering sacrifices, something that only a prophet was supposed to do, something that King Saul wasn't allowed to do by God. But instead, King Saul, because of people and because he wanted to please people, he ended up providing the sacrifice. And because of that one act right there, the Bible says that God himself took his spirit away from King Saul. He said, "King Saul, that right there costed you your kingship. That move right there, you people pleasing, You trying to get your identity from other people. That right there has costed you your kingship. And we know the story. God begins to anoint and appoint a man named David, someone who found his identity in God. So number one, your identity cannot come from other people. Lesson number two, your identity cannot come from your performance. Your identity cannot come from your accomplishments, nor can your identity come from a lack of accomplishments. Many times as I talk to young people, this is one thing I'll discover, especially Christians. They believe that the value of their worth is dependent on what they produce, what they achieve, and what they accomplish. See, they show up to church not because they love God, because they think that if they show up to church, it means that they will receive the love of God. They show up to church and they serve on the praise team not because of an overflow of love, but because they want to be seen by other people. Because they think, if I serve on the praise team, if I serve the church, if I do these quote-unquote religious things, it must mean God loves me. It must mean that I'm getting somewhere with God. And then in the vice versa, I've seen a lot of young people, especially young Christians, who they allow shame, a lack of accomplishments, messing up, sin, shame, to actually determine the value of their worth. They allow shame to speak into their identity. They allow a lack of accomplishments and guilt to speak into their identity. So they go on their whole life thinking that they're not good enough, thinking that they'll never amount to anything because of past mistakes. Pastor Danny, you don't understand what I've been through. Pastor Danny, because of this, God can't love me. And they allow either shame to dictate their identity, or they allow their accomplishments and pride to dictate their identity. Newsflash, YG, your identity cannot come from your accomplishments. Accomplishments and a lack of accomplishments cannot speak into your identity. King Saul is another example once again. King Saul in 1 Samuel chapter 18, this is where David really begins to pop off on the stage. In other words, he's growing in popularity. He defeats Goliath, bam, with the slingshot. You guys know the story. And now David, he's a part of King Saul's army, and King Saul sends David out to war, and David is now conquering enemies left and right. And now he's coming home, and now he got groupies, and now he got ladies who are coming out of the house, and they're literally singing songs. This is what the Bible says. Read it. It's very interesting. They made songs. They're saying stuff like, David, hey, hey, David, hey, hey, David slayed 10,000, hey, 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 but Saul only slayed 1,000, hey, hey. Literally, that's what the Bible is saying. There's a funny passage. If you want to look it up, search up Michael Todd David song, and you will find the craziest trap version of that song. It's crazy. But anyways, they are now in a place where they're exalting David. They're applauding David. They're saying, David, you are amazing. You're slaying 10,000. Saul, 1,000. King Saul, 1,000. And now Saul, he gets jealous. Why? Because he's allowed accomplishments or a lack of accomplishments to dictate his value and his identity. Because of that, he's now growing jealous. Because of a lack of accomplishments, he's now growing jealous. Because of a lack of accomplishments, he doesn't think he's good enough, and therefore he's trying to kill David. In the same way, if we allow accomplishments to try to speak into our identity, we grow prideful. If we allow lack of accomplishments to speak into our identity, we grow shameful. And I wonder how many of you guys, YG, even right now as I'm speaking, this is reflecting to you and this is relating to you. Because so many of you guys have tried to serve God, not because you love him, but because in your mind you have believed a lie. You have believed a lie that says the value of your worth is only as good as what you do. You are what you do. You have believed that lie, therefore you are serving God not out of an overflow of love, but because you want to earn his love. Because you think by serving God, that must mean that God's gonna bless you later on down the road. I got news flash for you, YG. You have fallen into the second lie, which is identity does not come from your accomplishments. Let me speak to those who right now might be dealing with shame. YG, I was once there too. YG, I was once there where I thought I would never, ever amount to anything because of shame in my life. I'll talk to you guys more about it in a little bit. But I messed up so many times in my life where I allow shame to dictate, man, God can't use me. God can't love me. If people find out what I did, oh my goodness, they're never gonna like me. They're gonna call me names. They're gonna call me nasty. They're gonna call me loser. I can't do it, Pastor Danny. YG, don't let shame speak into your identity. Your identity cannot come from shame. Your identity does not come from your past mistakes. Your identity does not come from your failures. Your identity does not come from the mistakes you made last night. It does not. So lie number one, lesson number one, your identity does not come from people. Lesson number two, your identity does not come from your accomplishments, your performance, your lack of accomplishments. So finally, and this is the main thing I want to say. Therefore, your identity can only come from knowing God. I know it sounds cliche, but your identity can only come from God. If God is really the creator of the universe, if he is the master creator and you are his creation, he is the only one allowed to speak original design into your life. He is the only one with access, with privilege, with authority to speak into your life and to actually determine who he created you to be. Nothing else. No one else. It's important we catch this. I want to say it this way, and I want you guys to write this down. Right view of God will equal right view of self. Let me say that one more time. Right view of God will equal right view of self. In other words, if you truly want to discover your identity, it begins with discovering a right view of God. Genuinely knowing who God is. Which is why yesterday we had to talk about loving God. Which is why yesterday we had to talk about who this Jesus really is. And really falling in love with Jesus. Now I want to tell you guys a story because this blew my mind. A couple years ago, I decided with me and my sister to take our youth pastor, the one I mentioned yesterday, and her daughter. We wanted to take her daughter to a trampoline house. Now if you guys have never been to a trampoline house, you guys are missing out. You guys are for real missing out. I don't care how young you are, I don't care how old you are. You need to go to a trampoline house. It is the most fun I've ever had in my life. Just kidding. It's not that, okay, it is fun. Focus. Anyways, we wanted to take her out, so I said, yo, youth pastor, don't even worry about it. We got it. She's like, no, let me pay for her name, Sydney. Let me pay for Sydney. I said, don't even worry about it. We got it. We got it. So me and my sister, we're gonna take them out. We're gonna take her and her friend out. So I'm like, okay, we gotta buy tickets. So I go online and I'm searching it up, trampoline house, and I look up the prices, and I promise you, YG, I almost became a sinner because when I saw the price, I almost cursed. It said $40 per person. For about 3 hours, it was $40. Now, I don't know about y'all, but youth pastors, we broke. We got no money. We ain't bougie. We broke. And I remember reading it, I'm like, oh my goodness, it's $40, but wait a minute, Sydney is only 8 years old. Let me see how much it is for an 8-year-old, because it's probably a lot cheaper. So I scrolled down and I'm looking and finally found it. And this is what it said verbatim. Ages 8 and up, $40. Ages 7 and below, $20. She just missed the cut by 1 year. If she's only 1 year younger, we would end up saving $20. So I did what any Christian would do. I said, hey, Sydney, how old are you? And she said, she's 8. So I told her, no, you're not. I said, hey, Sydney, from today, just for today, you are 7 years old. And she looks at me. Okay. I said, okay, so let's practice. Sydney, how old are you? And she looks at me. I'm 8. I'm like, no, Sydney, no, come on. We went over this. Just for today, you are 7 years old, okay? And she looks at me, she's like, okay. So I ask her again, right? We have to practice because when the front desk asks, we need to make sure we get it down to the T. So I asked her, Sydney, how old are you? And she's thinking, I'm 8. I'm like, no. We tried for a couple minutes and it just didn't work. So we ended up paying the full $40. And afterwards, I asked Sydney, I was like, Sydney, why couldn't you just say you were 7 years old today? Come on, Sydney. I didn't tell the reason why, you know. I couldn't say it's because I'm trying to save $20 that I'm making you sin. I couldn't. But I told her, I asked her, Sydney, why couldn't you just say you're 7 years old today? And she looks at me, and YG, I promise you, I felt God speaking to me. I felt the Holy Spirit all over this. And she looks at me and she says this, because Pastor Danny, my daddy told me I'm 8 years old. She said, Pastor Danny, my dad told me I am 8 years old. In other words, what she is saying is that she knew that her father had said, Sydney, you are 8 years old. So when an outsider comes in trying to lie to her, trying to manipulate and try to say you're seven, she said, no. You may try to claim that I'm 7 years old, but my daddy told me I'm eight. In the same way, she understood that because she had a right view of her father, she had a right view of her identity. In the same way, YG, if you guys understand who your father is, if you guys understand who your father says you are, that you are loved, that you're beloved, that he's absolutely proud of you, that you don't have to earn his approval, you don't have to live for anybody else, but when he looks at you, you are his son and daughter. You are a child of God, the heir of God, the co-heir with Christ. That changes everything. So the next time someone tries to come along and claim and try to lie to you and try to manipulate, try to speak identity over you, you know, no. My father told me who I am. The next time performance and accomplishments and shame try to lie to you, you say, no. My father told me who I am. The next time the enemy tries to come and manipulate and lie to you, say, you're a disgrace. You can't ever amount to anything. You're not good enough. If you want to be approved, take nasty pictures. If you want to be approved, do nasty things. You'll say, no. My father told me who I am. He says, I am a son, I am a daughter, I am loved, I am approved. Therefore, I don't ever have to live for anyone else. Therefore, my identity does not come from anyone else. It only comes from the Father. YG, I need y'all to understand this. Ladies, let me speak to you for a second, ladies. This is important. Because did you know your father calls you beautiful? Did you know the Heavenly Father called you his one precious daughter? Did you know the Bible says that you are a beloved of God? The Bible says in Zephaniah that he is delighted in you. So next time a boy tries to come along and he tries to flatter you with his words and say, hey cutie, how you doing? You look him in the eye and you say, cutie, son, my father calls me beautiful. You better get out of here. Don't even talk to me. My father tells me I'm beautiful. My father tells me I'm beloved. Go and get a step in. For real, let that boy know that you know who you are because your father has spoken identity over you. Fellas, it works the same way. The next time a Jezebel tries to come up to you and say, hey, cutie, how you doing? You tell her. Beautiful, cutie. My father says I'm his son. My father says I'm good looking. My father says I'm handsome. My father says I'm a protector of women. My father says I'm a defender of his children. Get out of here, Jezebel. Don't even talk to me. For real, YG. This is so crucial we understand this because there is a real attack on your identity. Your generation, more than any other generation, is the most confused because of identity. And it's crucial you guys find your identity not from other people, not from your performance, but genuinely only from God. It is the only way. But it starts right view of God equals right view of self. Important you catch this. Don't forget Romans. Romans says that you are children of God. Not only children, but the Spirit has adopted you to be firstborn son status. All that God has, he wants to give to you as a firstborn son. But Pastor Daniel, I'm a daughter. This doesn't matter. Many times the Bible actually, whenever it says son, it can be replaced with just child. But this one is specifically talking about son because it's referring to firstborn son status. So even if you're a daughter, it's referring to you being a firstborn son status. Important that we catch this. YG, I'm telling you, this changes everything. Because for many of you guys have believed a lie about yourself, about your identity. You guys have believed shame about your identity. You guys have believed lies that says, I'm only as good as what I can produce. I'm only as good as what I accomplish. I'm only as good as the people I hang out with. I'm only as good if that boy or that girl likes me. I'm only as good if people give me certain amounts of like on Instagram. If you're not careful, what you will end up doing, you will compromise your conviction, you compromise the value of your word trying to please other people or trying to please that accomplishment. But once again, your identity does not come from people. Your identity does not come from performance. Your identity comes from God. It is the only way you begin to realize fully who God has said you are, who God has created you to be. Only the Creator can tell the creation the purpose of His creation. Only the Creator can actually speak original design to His creation. It is only once we understand who God says we are that we end up genuinely being satisfied in the fullness of who God has created us to be. That right there is identity. Now, YG, why am I so passionate about this? Because this has been a lifelong journey for me, and it robbed me of many years of my life trying to discover my identity, trying to realize and trying to break off all these lies that I began to believe about myself. See, even got me into a place where because I live for the approval of man, I live for the approval of people, I've allowed people to dictate my identity. It even led me to places where I ended up getting arrested when I was 16 years old, caught shoplifting, only because my friends did it. Just because my friend said, Danny, if you want to be a part of us, you got to do this. Danny, because you roll with us, you got to do this. So I ended up stealing and I got arrested for shoplifting at the age of 16 years old. Handcuffed to the back of a police car, taken to prison, got my fingerprint scanned, everything. My parents had to pick me up and it broke our family apart, man. It really messed us up. Why? Because I found my identity in people. I've allowed people to dictate who I really was. Now fast forward a couple more years, I got to a place where I was so confused, YG. I was desperately searching for my identity. The whole time I grew up in church, but even in church, it was no different. I was just doing all these things, hoping that by doing so, it must mean that God can love me. It must mean that I'll get the approval of God. It must mean I'll get people to say, wow, look at Danny, look at the way he's serving. And so the whole time, my identity was so shaky. My identity was lost. I was so confused. The only thing I desired to genuinely know was who was I created to be? Who am I? At the end of the day, who am I? Because I hated this pretend me. I hated this fake me. And so one day I got to a place, 18 years old, dark, lonely. Genuinely, I remember waking up in the middle of the night as a freshman in college, praying, God, I pray I won't wake up in the morning. That's how dark I was. That's how lonely I was. And I got to a place where I genuinely wished that and prayed that. But YG, I am telling you, your identity comes from a right view of God and therefore a right view of self. It can only come from God. One day in the lowest moment of my life, God begins to show me a picture in the screen of my mind, the vision of young people like you guys, your age, going around the major cities of America, praying for the sick, seeing people get healed supernaturally, casting out demons. Loving on the lost, loving on the homeless, loving on the ones that least deserve our love. And man, it was the most beautiful thing I've seen in my mind. People were coming to know Jesus Christ through these young people. And finally, the scene begins to shift and is now in like this Central Park where all these people who met God through these young people are all together in the Central Park, hands lifted up, crying, tears running down their face because they encountered God. And I remember in that moment, I heard a voice in my heart. It wasn't an audible voice, but it was a voice in my heart. And I remember God saying this to me. He says, son, this is what I've created you for. This is who I am. This is what I've created you for. You've been searching for purpose and identity your whole life. This is who I've created you for. This is what I've created you for. This is your identity. Son, would you like to be a part of this? Everything in my heart, everything in my spirit leaped for joy. It was like I came alive for the first time. Why? Because I got a proper view of God and God began to speak identity over me. It didn't come from people. It didn't come from my accomplishments or my performance. It came from God. And when God began to speak right view and right identity to me, YG, it changed my life. That vision that I saw no longer became a vision. It became a reality. That's what happened. When God speaks identity into you, what he is doing, he is pinpointing and pulling out the creation that he created. He is speaking original design to your to this creation. No matter what people might have said about you, no matter what your performance might have dictated, when God begins to speak identity to you, that is your identity. That's what propels you. That is what it means to genuinely get to a place where you are content and satisfied in all that God has created you to be. Now what we're gonna do, we're gonna uproot some of these lies that you've gone to believe. Maybe some of you guys have grown up to believe that your identity came from people, and you've allowed your people, your friends, your family, maybe the girl you like, the boy you like, social media, to dictate your identity. Those are all lies. We gotta pluck that out, root that out. Maybe you've allowed your performance, shame, your lack of approval, your lack of accomplishments. Maybe you've allowed that to dictate your identity. Those are all lies we gotta pluck out as well. The value of your worth is not dependent on your performance. The value of your worth is not dependent on your accomplishments. The value of your worth is not dependent on your failures or your mistakes. The value of your worth has been settled on the cross. And therefore, God is the only one who has authority to speak life and identity into you. Now, YG, what I want us to do, I actually want us to go into a time of response. What we're going to do, we're going to begin to figure out and pray for these lies that we've gone to believe about ourselves to be plucked out, to be uprooted, to be revealed. And instead, what we're going to do, we're going to receive the love of the Father. And you're going to hear the Father say, "You are my son. You are my daughter. You are my child. I have adopted you into sonship. You are rightful heir. You are co-heir with Christ." I want you guys to begin to receive the love of the Father, the approval of the Father, the identity of the Father. So what we're going to do right now, we're actually begin to uproot some of these lies. So my question is this: what are some of the lies that you have gone to believe about yourself? Maybe it's from other people. Maybe it's from your performance. Maybe it's from yourself. I want you to figure out that lie. I want you to figure out those lies. I know it might hurt. I know it's gonna do a lot of searching inside, but what are the lies you have gone to believe about yourself, about your identity? And after that, what we're gonna do, we're gonna spend some time praying, and I want you guys to receive the blessing and the love of the Father and say, "You are my son, you are my daughter, and I'm so proud of you." So YG, let me pray for us, and I'll let you guys go and process this out. So Father, I thank you, every eye's closed. Father, I thank you for every single person in this room. Let them hear clearly, Lord, your voice that says, "This is my son, this is my daughter with whom I'm well pleased." Father, I thank you that right now, every single person here, that they will receive the identity from the Father. Lord, that every single lie that they have gone to believe about themselves will be plucked out and revealed. And instead, what will be replaced is the true original design and identity spoken by the Father himself. So Lord, I bless this group. I bless this group. I bless this group to hear your voice, to receive their God-given identity, their original design spoken over them. And Lord, we declare that their identity cannot come from people, it cannot come from performance, but it can only come from you. And that a right view of God will equal a right view of self. So Holy Spirit, we pray right now that you will reveal to them the lies that they have believed and that you will replace it with the love, approval, affection, and identity of the Father. That they are your child, that they are your children, and that you have adopted them into your family. So we love you, Lord. We thank you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys.